Pour your spirit out, oh God. That we who are gathered here this morning to worship you may know your presence in our midst. Receive our prayers, receive our praise. Speak to us, oh God, through the words of Scripture. And allow your servant words of proclamation that are truly good news. And let me hide beneath the shadow of the cross. So that the words of my mouth and meditations of all of our hearts are pleasing and acceptable to you, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Amen. If you ask almost, I won't say anyone, but if you ask almost any Christian to say something about Thomas the disciple, almost without question, you will get a reference to the story we read from John's gospel this morning. We've even given Thomas an identifying kind of name, right? Doubting Thomas. That's what we've come to call him over the years. And it's very easy to see how people could read this story and look at Thomas as being one who is full of doubt and one who is maybe lacking faith, especially if we just read this story and if we just read this story like we so often do very quickly. Because that's what we do with stories that are very familiar to us, particularly out of Scripture. If we've heard the story over and over, we often just read through it very quickly without really looking at or without really hearing the words. We rely more on the memories of what we have heard someone else tell us about that story, maybe even years ago. I do the same thing. I can remember when I was like these children that were just here. I can remember as a child learning that Thomas was one of the bad disciples, right? That he was second only to Judas in terms of disciples that we were not supposed to be like. Don't be like Thomas. I can remember people saying, don't be like Thomas. He's not very faithful. He's a doubter. You don't want to be like that. Do you hear a but coming? See, but I think Thomas has gotten a really bad rap over the years, especially in the church. Maybe not this church, but in the church in general. I think Thomas has been singled out very unfairly by the church throughout history for supposedly having too little faith. Personally, I don't think Thomas's faith should be questioned any more than any of the other disciples. In fact, I would argue that Thomas's faith is far from lacking. There are times in the Jesus story where Thomas was, the way I read it, maybe more faithful than all the others. If we go back just a few chapters in John's gospel to the 11th chapter, we read a story that maybe you remember hearing. Jesus was preparing to go back to Judea. He had been through Judea and left. Now he's going to go back. And he's going to go back to Judea because his friend Lazarus has died. Jesus had gotten word that his friend Lazarus had died. And all the disciples that were with him were trying to convince Jesus not to go back to this very dangerous place because it was in Judea that the Jewish authorities had tried to kill Jesus. If you don't recall that, go back when you get home this afternoon and read the story in John chapter 11. And all the disciples except one said, don't go. But one said, if the master's going back, then let's go, let's all go, you remember, and die with him. That guy was Thomas. Thomas, the one that we have become accustomed to being very quick to accuse as being weak of faith and full of doubt, was the only one of Jesus' disciples who was ready to go back with Jesus to face the danger. And that's a compelling story. But there's another story about Thomas that speaks to me at an even deeper level. It's a story that speaks to me because I can relate to it. It speaks to me at a very, very personal level. In the 14th chapter of John's Gospel, in a section called the Farewell Discourse, it's one of the last teaching moments that Jesus has with the disciples. He's telling them everything that he wants them, all the important things that he wants them to know and that he wants them to really grasp. He's talking to the disciples for the last time before he is given over to the authorities and is crucified. It's called the Farewell Discourse. And in the Farewell Discourse, Jesus says to the disciples, in my Father's mansion are many rooms. Remember that? In my Father's mansion are many rooms. I'm going there to prepare a place for you. You know the way to where I'm going. You know the way. Every time I read this, I think back to my days in seminary. I had this class in seminary, and it was in the spring semester. It was actually about this time of year, getting close to the end of the semester, and it was one of those classes that was right after lunch. It was right after lunch, late in the semester, in the spring class. Man, those are the hardest classes. The sun was bright, it was shining through the window, the room was warm. You think you want to go take a nap right now, man. I'll tell you what. And the professor was trying to explain a particularly difficult to grasp theological concept. And I was not the only one that was really not paying attention. All of us in the class had kind of glassy eyes and finding it difficult to stay awake. And every time the professor asked a question, we did the bobblehead nod. You know, we're nodding, but we don't know what we're nodding about. And at one point, the professor stopped and asked if we were understanding what it was he was saying. We didn't. But nobody was going to admit that we didn't, not to him or to each other. We were just nodding. All of us did that except for one. Thank goodness for Claudia. Claudia would be the one that would save us from ourselves. She was always the one. Claudia sat in the front row right in front of the professor. Claudia is a dear, dear friend of mine. She sat in the front row. I was in the back row, closest to the door.
Like a good Methodist.
Like a good Methodist. Claudia in front row. She was the one, because she was always the one, that stood up and said something. And Claudia in this class, when he asked, do you understand, Claudia jumped up and said, and she had that look, right? No, we don't understand. We don't understand a thing you're saying. Just about like that.
That's Claudia.
You know her.
I know her.
Thomas was like Claudia. I can imagine the disciples sitting there glassy-eyed, confused, doing the bobblehead nod as Jesus is giving the farewell discourse. And he says, you know the way of where I'm going. And they didn't. But Thomas saved them from themselves. Thomas was the one that jumped up and said, no, Lord, we don't know. Look at their faces. They don't have a clue. How are we supposed to know if you don't tell us? Thomas was faithfully committed. Thomas was honest. And Thomas was practical. Thomas did not lack faith any more than any of the other disciples. You remember the story when the Marys came to the tomb. Even though the angels told them that Jesus was not there, Mary did not get the resurrection. She didn't get it until Jesus revealed himself to her. And then when she goes and tells Peter and the others that the tomb was empty, that she had seen Jesus, well, they didn't get the resurrection either. Remember, they run to the tomb and they leave confused. Even though Jesus had told them beforehand what was going to happen. Did they doubt? Do we beat them up because their faith was weak? What we read in John's gospel today tells us that Jesus showed them all. He showed them all his hands and his side. They all looked at his wounds. Thomas wasn't asking for anything more than the others had already received. In fact, except for those in that room, either that first day or the next week when Thomas was there, except for those folks, those first disciples, no one, not all the earliest Christians, not Paul, not the saints of the church that have lived throughout history, no one, especially us, no one, except for those few, could say, I have seen Jesus face to face. I have felt the wounds in his hands. I have touched the wound in his side. Nobody can say that. We can't. By virtue of history, we're on the wrong side of that locked door. But guess what? So were the disciples. They were all cowering in fear and confusion behind a locked door. They were hiding after Jesus had died. And yet, Jesus still shows up. Presents himself to them, standing there in their midst. And when he shows up, he shows them hands and side. When you get down to it, Thomas did not ask any more than the others. And for me, that's what makes Thomas so relatable. Because we all do that. We all do that. See, Thomas had to find out firsthand for himself about the risen Christ. Thomas has to experience Jesus just like the others, just like we all do. None of us can truly believe until we have experienced for ourselves the risen Christ coming to us, revealing himself to us, and doing that in a very intimate and a powerful way. So instead of rebuking Thomas, Jesus says to him, out of great love, out of great compassion, without reprimand or rebuke, Jesus generously and lovingly and compassionately offers himself to the disciples and later to Thomas. The risen Christ meets Thomas' conditions, the very conditions that Thomas has established for his faith. He wanted to see the wounds. And every one of us, everyone in this room, everyone watching on television or checking us out online, worshiping with us online, every one of us, if we are honest with ourselves, is like Thomas. Every one of us has established the conditions for our faith. We all have certain conditions that must be met satisfactorily in our minds and in our hearts for our faith to be real. And oftentimes these are deeply personal experiences of God's Spirit moving in unique ways in our lives. And God does not reprimand or rebuke us for asking for this. On the contrary, as Jesus compassionately gave Thomas what he needed to believe, God will also somehow, with great compassion, very lovingly give us what we need in order to believe. Faith is a gift. A few years ago, my mother was taken by ambulance to the hospital, the emergency room, very early, about 2 a.m. on an Easter Sunday morning. My dad and my sister thought she was having a stroke. It wasn't until a couple of days later, after all the tests, that we learned that it was not a stroke, that she would, in fact, make a full and a complete recovery. She would just have to stay in bed for a couple of weeks, but that the doctors assured us that she would be okay. And I had talked with my sister, I had talked with my father, but no conversation with either one of them would suffice. It's not that I did not believe them, it's not that I doubted anything that they were saying, but I needed to hear my mother's voice. I needed to experience her voice, her words, before I could be at ease. Faith is a gift. Belief comes through experience. It's one thing to be told something wonderful. It's another thing entirely to experience it. You know, Thomas should have been able to believe the disciples' proclamation that Jesus was, in fact, alive. The other disciples should have been able to believe Mary's proclamation when she returned from the tomb, but Mary could not ever experienced the resurrected Jesus for them. And they, as a group, could not experience the resurrected Jesus for Thomas. You see, for Jesus, Thomas's faith was much more important than his grounds for faith, than his reasons for faith, right? It didn't matter to Jesus what Thomas needed. It mattered that he needed. And when Thomas finally does get it, really gets it, Thomas makes the most powerful confession found in anywhere in Scripture. My Lord, my God. And the good news is that today we still can have this intimate experience of Jesus Christ giving us what we need to believe. In every generation, there are many and marvelous ways the risen Christ is seen in the world. Many ways. And every time that happens, it's like a stone being thrown into the waters of a lake. It creates ripples. And the ripples began to expand. And it touches every part of the lake. And we get to share that. We experience the risen Christ in the compassion of others that we come in contact with in our lives, especially in those times of our deepest need. And others experience the risen Christ through acts of compassion that we share and that we show. We are all conduits of this grace. We are all ripples in this lake when we allow God to work in us and through us. When we show compassion to others, the ripples broaden and expand and spread. This story is a story of love and acceptance. This story of Thomas is a story of great compassion for Thomas and for all disciples and really for all people, even us. It's a story of hope. It's a story of promise for all generations. It's a story for you and me about the way that Christ gives us what we need for faith. And someday, as we grow in our understanding of how God works, is at work in our lives and in the world around us, maybe, hopefully, we can believe without conditions. But until then, for all of us, regardless of where we find ourselves, Christ extends to us the invitation to look upon his wounds, to touch his hands, to experience him in the compassion of others. And the ripples keep expanding, ever widening, including us all. What do you need? What do you need in order to believe? As generous and compassionate as Jesus' gesture towards Thomas was, we can be assured that Jesus' love and acceptance and grace will be equally available to us all as well, without limit, without measure, so that we might believe. This was good news for the disciples. It was good news for Thomas. It is good news for us all. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.